Why is it that every time a new camera comes out, y'all gotta hit the internet? Oh my God, the Sony Alpha 1 is better than the R5 and blase skip. Is it y'all trying to justify your camera purchases? Like, why can't we just let cameras be great in their own right? Y'all do the same thing with LeBron and Michael Jordan. Y'all do the same thing with everything. Like, just let the cameras come out and just be great, because honestly, we live in a time where all cameras are fantastic. Let's just be honest. What up, y'all? Terry Warfield. Hope you're having a good day so far. If this is your first time here, a big fat welcome to you. And if you're part of the fam, you're part of the squad, and you came back, welcome back. So this new Sony Alpha 1, whew, I was not expecting this camera. Sony just kind of came out of left field today. Honestly, when I got the email from Sony that, you know, there's a meeting that I need to attend, I'm thinking that it's just a normal, you know, we're talking about something small. I did not expect it to be probably one of the greatest cameras ever made. Out of left field, they didn't mention it. But huge respect to Sony, real quick. And huge respect to all camera brands, but especially Sony, because Sony has been pumping out cameras left and right, and they're not like junk cameras, you know what I'm saying? They've come out with a bunch of consumer grade cameras, the A7S III, the A7Rs, the RX series. Now this, man, you gotta give it up to Sony. Even though the cameras are not perfect, some things could still be changed on all of the cameras. One thing you gotta remember is even when we get cameras like the Sony Alpha 1, a lot of times those features trickle down into cameras that we can afford, because I'm telling you right now, with the Sony Alpha 1 being $6,500, I cannot afford it. And most people probably can't, but let's answer that question real quick. Who is this camera really for? Is it for me and you, the casual YouTubers, or a casual person who takes family photos, or maybe does like event photography, like, you know, baby showers and stuff like that? No, this camera is not for that. This camera is a professional grade camera. At $6,500, it just ought to be, but it's a professional grade camera. This is meant for people who have to do like journalism, they have to do professional sports photography, they have to do professional landscape or wildlife photography. This is not for the average Joe. So a lot of y'all are complaining about, oh, this camera costs too much XYZ. It ain't for you. So that's one thing y'all gotta remember. Now, although I cannot afford this camera, it is very exciting to see Sony continue to push the envelope. And I know I sound like a fanboy, but I just get so excited about all of these freaking new features. So let's talk about some of these specs from the Sony Alpha 1. Next, I'm gonna go through the specs that I personally loved after watching the presentation and also after attending the Sony briefing today. Yo, it's a lot to talk about, man. And it might sound like I'm just blurting off specs, but that's because there's so much crap to talk about. But before we get into the video, real quick, if this is your first time here, you like camera content, you like some sauce, you like personality, you like information, make sure you hit the subscribe button and hit the thumbs up button. Y'all don't understand how important that thumbs up button, that thing right there, you don't understand how important that is. So just go ahead and take care of that right now. Now, I got a paper right here with some of my favorite stuff on here. So 50 megapixel stacked CMOS sensor at 30 frames per second. Wow, you know how much processing power that takes. This thing is way faster than the Sony A9 II and the A7R4. It's got an anti-flicker shutter. So this is on some cinema cameras, but it's dope to see this melting down into photography cameras such as the Alpha 1. So what that means is, like, for those situations where you might be shooting into LED lights or lights that have flicker, sometimes the default shutter speed increments in the camera, they don't cut it, they don't get rid of the flicker. Well, on the Alpha 1, you can actually customize the shutter down to decimal points to get rid of flicker in those situations. And while we're talking about the shutter, it is a carbon fiber shutter. Carbon fiber shutter, and also it is spring actuated and some other type of wizardry that they put in there. Ultimately, what that means is you can go super crazy fast with the shutter. Let me finish going through all of this stuff that I want to talk about, okay? So anti-flicker, we get lossless compressed RAW, which everybody's been talking about. Everybody's been asking for that, even though it's not a big deal to me, but I'm not a person that is in a situation where I need that, but I get why it's important to some people. So the thing is, with this 30 frames per second, it is blackout free with full autofocus. But you gotta think about, like I said, how much data at 50 megapixels per photo and 30 frames per second that this camera has to be able to push with autofocus, with real-time tracking, and all of that stuff. And while we're talking about the tracking, it now tracks birds, it now tracks bears, it probably can track freaking aliens, yo. Like, Sony got it down pack when it comes to autofocus, and it carries out 120 autofocus calculations per second. And the reason that's huge, because if you got a camera that can shoot bursts of 30 frames a second, you don't want 29 of those pictures out of focus. So this is gonna be huge for people who do like racing photography or sports photography, anything that involves super high speed shooting. This is gonna be clutch. You also got things like pixel shift in this camera, so you could get up to 199 megapixel photos. I'm gonna just break it down. This is like a A7S III mixed with an A9 II mixed with an A7 R4. All of them got drunk, had a party, had a baby, and it's the Sony Alpha 1. The other thing about the Sony Alpha 1, max flash sync speed of 1/400th of a second. Say that 10 times fast. I get tongue tied every time I try to do that. But up to a 1/400th of a second, which is huge for a lot of people because most cameras only go up to like maybe 2/50th of a second with flash using a mechanical shutter. And because the readout of this sensor is so freaking fast, we don't even really need global shutter no more. But you can shoot at some crazy fast shutter speeds because the readout of the sensor is so freaking fast. I think the max shutter speed is like 1/32,000th of a second. But let me go ahead and talk about video real quick, okay? 8K up to 30 frames per second. It is 10-bit, 420, and you can use regular SD cards. But the 8K is actually oversampled from 8.6K. It's a 30-minute record limit, and there's no RAW or anything like that at 8K. However, what you can do is use things like S-Log. You can use all the other picture profiles, and it has S-Cinetone, which is kind of pissing me off because the A7S III doesn't have it, even though it's rumored to be getting it. But S-Cinetone, and then you still get all of the same things that you get from the A7S III. So you get the 4K, 120 frames per second, all live, 422, 10-bit internal, RAW over HDMI to an external recorder. And you get the dual card slot, CF Express Type A, which you'll still need to use that CF Express Type A for the 4K. You also get crop mode in photo and video. For photos, it's like 21 megapixels. For crop mode in 4K, it's actually an oversampled 5.6K image. So that's huge. Like, I know a lot of people haven't said a lot about that, but that is huge because think about it. In cinema, there's still a lot of crop sensor cameras going around. So to be able to get a 4K oversampled image in crop mode, that's kind of crazy. I wish the A7S III had something like that, but it doesn't. So what else? It's the same EVF from the Sony A7S III, which is freaking fantastic. And it's 240 frames per second versus 120 frames per second. The rear screen, unfortunately, is not a flip out screen like the A7S III, but a flip up screen like the A7 R4, Sony A9 II, A7 III. And a lot of y'all are kind of mad about this, which I don't understand why. I mean, I guess I do understand why, because a lot of people want the flip out screen. But you got to remember, this is more so a photography camera first with a ton of video features in it. Most photographers don't like taking pictures with the screen out to the side. Most photographers, I'm one of them, prefer a screen that kind of tilts up towards you or tilts down so you can take pictures from above. Not saying I don't love the flip out screen on the A7S III, because I do, but if I'm a photographer first, I'm not mad that it doesn't have a flip out screen. Now, it does have the menu system, the touch screen from the A7S III. So even though it's not flippy screen, you still get the new menu system and all that good stuff. A few other things that got me super hyped. Faster Wi-Fi, two radios in it. They're both 2x2 MIMO Wi-Fi antennas, which means crazy fast wireless transfer rates. Full-size HDMI, you got a LAN port, you got a flash sync port, you got a USB 3.2 port. The other thing that really blew me away is that new Sony Xperia, how you could kind of use that as a monitor and output that over 5G in real time. That's crazy. That monitor can actually like view content on the screen in 4K, whereas most monitors are like 1080p. But anyways, $6,500. Now that we got all the specs out the way, I missed a whole lot of stuff, don't get me wrong, because there's a lot of crazy stuff and technology in that camera. The gist of what I'm trying to get at is I think it's worth the price of admission. $6,500 for a professional camera, although not perfect. I'm sure we would like to see improved ergonomics. Come on, Sony, we've been using the same body for like 20 years. And better screens, but as a whole, You cannot be mad at this camera. I'm surprised it didn't cost more than $6,500 considering everything that's in this camera. But again, I wanna stress the fact that the camera ain't meant for everybody. It's not for vloggers, it's not for us YouTube heads. This is people who really take photography and video serious as a working professional in those situations, or for people that just got the bag and they just wanna spend it. But again, I'm excited to see a lot of these upgrades start to trickle down to all other cameras. And is this the EOS R5 killer? I don't know, debatable, right? If we did wanna compare cameras, because the EOS R5 is half the price. So it depends on the things that you place value in. I can't answer that question for you. I can't even tell you if it is better than any other professional camera out there. But what I can tell you is, based off of what I saw today, I am extremely impressed with the new Alpha 1. Even though I'll never own one, or at least no time soon, I'm still impressed and it's dope to see the innovation. But anyways, $6,500, what are your thoughts, man? I would love to hear them. And again, if you have made it this far, shout out to you. Make sure you subscribe, make sure you drop a comment, and a like if you haven't done so already. So till next time, I'm out. Peace and chicken grease, Terry Warfield. Peace!